In the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Welcome to a different and dramatic service. We will now follow Jesus in the worst day of his life here on earth. Good Friday. What happened that day changed our history, our lives, and our future. A reading from Mark 14. When they had sung the hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. And Jesus said to them, You will all become deserters. For it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep will be scattered. But after I am raised up, I will go before you to Galilee.
Peter said to him, even though all become deserters, I will not.
And Jesus said to them, him, truly I tell you, this day, this very night, before the cock crows twice, you will deny me three times.
But he said vehemently, even though I must die with you, I will not deny you. And all of them said the same.
They went to a place called Gethsemane, and he said to his disciples, sit here while I pray. He took them with him, Peter and James and John, and began to be disturbed and agitated. And he said to them, I am deeply grieved, even to death. Remain here and keep awake. And going a little further, he threw himself on the ground and prayed that if it were possible, the hour might pass from him. He said, Abba, Father, for you all things are possible. Remove this cup from me. Yet not what I want, but what you want. He became and found them sleeping. And he said to Peter, Simon, are you asleep? Could you not keep awake 1 hour? Keep awake and pray that you may not come into the time of trial. The spirit indeed is willing, but the flesh is weak. And again he went away and prayed, saying the same words. and once more he came and found them sleeping. For their eyes were very heavy, and they did not know what to say to him. He came a third time and said to them, "Are you still sleeping and taking your rest? Enough! The hour has come. The Son of Man is betrayed into the hands of the sinners. Get up. Let us be going. See, my betrayer is at hand."
Immediately, while he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived, and with him there was a crowd with swords and clubs from the chief priests, the scribes, and the elders. Now the betrayer had given them a sign, saying, "The one I will kiss is the man. Arrest him and lead him away under guard." So when he came, he went up to him at once and said, "Rabbi," and kissed him. Then they laid hands on him and arrested him.
But one of those who stood near drew his sword and struck the slave of the high priest, cutting off his ear. Then Jesus said to them, "Have you come out with swords and clubs to arrest me as though I were a bandit? Day after day I was with you in the temple teaching, and you did not arrest me. But let the scriptures be fulfilled." All of them deserted him and fled. A certain young man was following him, wearing nothing but a linen cloth. They caught hold of him, but he left the linen cloth and ran off naked.
they took Jesus to a high priest. And all the chief priests, the elders, and the scribes were assembled. Peter had followed him at a distance, right into the courtyard, and the high priest. And he was sitting with the guards, warming himself at the fire.
Now the chief priests and the whole council were looking for testimony against Jesus to put him to death, but they found none. For many gave false testimony against him, and their testimony did not agree. Some stood up and gave false testimony against him, saying, "We heard him say, 'I will destroy this temple that is made with hands, and in 3 days I will build another, not made with hands.' But even on this point, their testimony did not agree. Then the high priest stood up before them and asked Jesus, 'Have you no answer? What is it that they testify against you?'
But he was silent and did not answer.
Again, the high priest asked him, 'Are you the Messiah, the Son of the Blessed One?'
Jesus said, 'I am. And you will see the Son of Man seated at the right hand of the power, and coming with the clouds of heaven.'
Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, 'Why do we still need witnesses? You have heard his blasphemy. What is your decision?' All of them condemned him as deserving death. Some began to spit on him, to blindfold him, and to strike him, saying to him, 'Prophesy.' The guards also took him over and beat him."
While Peter was below in the courtyard, one of the servant girls of the high priest came by. When she saw Peter warming himself, she stared at him and said, "You also were with Jesus, the man from Nazareth." But he denied it, saying, "I do not know or understand what you are talking about." And he went out into the forecourt. Then the cock crowed, and the servant girl, on seeing him, began again to say to the bystanders, "This man is one of them." But again, he denied it. Then after a little while, the bystanders again said to Peter, "Certainly you are one of them, for you are a Galilean." But he began to curse, and he swore an oath, "I do not know this man you are talking about." At that moment, the cock crowed for the second time. Then Peter remembered that Jesus had said to him, "Before the cock crows twice, you will deny me 3 times. And he broke down and wept.
As soon as it was morning, the chief priests held a consultation with the elders and scribes and the whole council. They bound Jesus, led him away, and handed him over to Pilate. Pilate asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?"
Jesus answered him, "You say so."
Then the chief priests accused him of many things. Pilate asked him again, "Have you no answer? See how many charges they bring against you." But Jesus made no further reply, so that Pilate was amazed. Now at the festival, he used to release a prisoner for them, anyone for whom they asked. Now a man called Barabbas was in prison with the rebels who had committed murder during the insurrection. So the crowd came and began to ask Pilate to do for them according to his custom. Then he answered them, "Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" For he realized that it was out of jealousy that the chief priests had handed him over. But the chief priests stirred up the crowd to have him release Barabbas for them instead. Pilate spoke to them again, "Then what do you wish me to do with a man you call the king of the Jews?"
They shouted back, "Crucify him!"
Pilate asked them, "Why? What evil has he done?"
But they shouted all the more, "Crucify him!"
So Pilate, wishing to satisfy the crowd, released Barabbas for them, and after flogging Jesus, he handed him over to be crucified. Then the soldiers led him into the courtyard of the palace, that is, the governor's headquarters, and they called together the whole cohort, and they clothed him in a purple cloak, and after twisting some thorns into a crown, they put it on him, and they began saluting him, "Hail, King of the Jews!" They struck his head with a reed, spat upon him, and knelt down in homage to him. After mocking him, they stripped him of the purple cloak and put his own clothes on him. Then they led him out to crucify him. They compelled a passerby who was coming in from the country to carry his cross. It was Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus. Then they brought Jesus to the place called Golgotha, which means the place of the skull. And they offered him wine mixed with myrrh, but he did not take it. And they crucified him and divided his clothes among them, casting lots to decide what each should take. It was 9 o'clock in the morning when they crucified him. The inscription of the charge against him read, "The King of the Jews."
And with him they crucified two bandits, one on his right and one on his left. Those who passed by derided him, shaking their heads and saying, "Aha! You who would destroy the temple and build it in 3 days, save yourself and come down from the cross." In the same way, the chief priests, along with the scribes, were also mocking him among themselves and saying, "He saved others, he cannot save himself. Let the Messiah, the King of Israel, come down from the cross now, so that we may see and believe." Those who were crucified with him also taunted him.
Noon, darkness came over the whole land until 3 in the afternoon. At 3 o'clock, Jesus cried out with a loud voice, "Eloi, Eloi, lema sabachthani," which means, my God, why have you forsaken me?" When some of the bystanders heard it, they said, "Listen, he is calling for Elijah." And someone ran, filled a sprung with sour wine, put it on a stick, and gave it to him to drink, saying, "Wait. Let us see whether Elijah will come to take him down." Then Jesus gave a loud cry and breathed his last.
and the curtain of the temple was torn in two from top to bottom. Now, when the centurion, who stood facing him, saw that in this way he breathed his last, he said, "Truly, this man was God's son." There were also women looking on from a distance. Among them were Mary Magdalene, and Mary, the mother of James the younger, and of Joseph and Salome. The word of the Lord.
What happened? Where were the faithful disciples and the women who had stood by Jesus' side? They watched from a distance because all attempt to defend Jesus failed. His friends could not do anything. All hope was gone. Jesus did not come down from the cross. He just said, my God, why have you forsaken me?" And that was perhaps exactly what all his friends now also felt. They were in a deep sorrow over losing him who they had trusted and set their hope on. And thus, they also lost faith in themselves. And they felt that God had left them. So the faith in God and the Son of God was gone. Where were the great crowds who followed Jesus and listened to his speeches? All the thousands in the wilderness who were fed by some fish and some bread? Where were they? Maybe they were brainwashed, caught in a mass suggestions, or just followed the crowd, shouting, "Crucify! Fiction! Crucifixion!" Were they trapped in the crowd's belief that salvation lay in killing Jesus, the King of the Jews, the Son of God? But this phenomenon still exists. It happens again and again in history in various forms. We are all in danger of being sucked into a bubble where we feel we have no choice apart from believing in the strong leader, because our only security we have is fellowship with those who go the same way, and then morality and decency and justice and truth are not so important anymore. Many people have experienced being in such a bubble where they are convinced that what they thought before is a lie, because there is an alternative truth. This happened in war, in captivity, in religious groups that isolate themselves, and even in families. We can be brainwashed into believing that our friends are our enemies, and we must fight them by all means. God becomes human for real. He came into our reality. And he and his followers also became a victim of this phenomenon. But Jesus let it happen. Until the last moment, he stood firm and prayed for those who did this to him. "Father, forgive them, because they do not know what they are doing." I cannot say more right now. But now my servant becomes a prayer. God, forgive us, because we do not know what we are doing. Jesus, you who love life most of all, you choose death so we could live. Your body is given to me. Your blood is shed for me. You became the grain of wheat that says yes to dying for love. There is no greater love. Help us receive it. Help us to follow in your footsteps. You who love by giving your life. And when everything is empty and dark, you say, "Stay in me." Stay in you? Then I'm already with you. I will remain with you
and increasingly choose you and have you stand for and what you stand for and are. And Jesus, stay you also in me, in my darkness and also in my most beautiful. Amen. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the communion of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Our Lord is dead. Go in peace. Thank you for joining us. On Sunday, we will hear what happened next. Welcome to online service on Easter Sunday. See you.